Hello.
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 Hello. We're heading off to a day in the life.
Welcome to my world.
Again, take three.
Oh, man. Hello, and welcome to the day in the life. Shut up, Mike. Day four. Howdy, and welcome to a day in the life of
Turn the car engine off.
Did somebody fart? I think you should keep that in the documentary, David, you know? Did somebody just fart?
I heard like it was a muffled.
Well, you would know about those for sure.
So it wasn't silent but deadly.
It sounded like it was coming in that from that direction.
Steph has sounds coming out of her I've never heard before.
Oh no.
They sound like little rabbits drowning and things like that. You know? Gurgling sounds.
Could we possibly find something more intelligent to talk about than farts?
Maybe.
But that's how we get started. You want it natural, David?
Would you like
it doesn't get natural. It doesn't get more natural than farts. I just did some good stuff.
I was actually listening, but I'd like to hear it again.
No, you weren't listening. You couldn't even hear me when I went mouse. You know?
I did hear you when you went mouse. That's why I came back.
See, I made Wade laugh. As long as I can make Wade laugh, I know I'm making things happen.
Who's Wade?
Wade is that guy behind the pussy over there.
That's bad. That would make the cut now.
Every single town and every single city looks exactly the same. It gets to the point you can't tell what state you're in. There's the Burger Kings, the McDonald's, the Holiday Inns, the Comfort Suites. Yeah, they all look the same. It all melts together. You get dizzy from it after a while. And, you know, the only thing that makes it worthwhile is that hour or two that you get to play on stage when you arrive at your destination. Mind you, sometimes all I want to find is a couple of really beautiful groupies.
Nobody's supposed to be in the car with him. He's supposed to be on his own.
What thing is that, David? This...
That shit? What are you talking about?
He likes me to go...
I don't remember you ever doing that.
I didn't yell at the time. I just went... He wanted silly. I give him silly.
Silly.
Slightly. Sorry.
Hello. Ready?
He started.
Hello.
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 Estonian. What's up, Marky? My bro. All right, there it is. What is this?
That's a rough cut.
It's
a rough mix from rough cut.
Start again. That's an outtake for sure.
We deal with that frustration.
Just put it away. Put it away, go sit down and talk, or go out and have a walk, whatever you got to do, and then come back and start fresh. Just start it over. You may even have to come back the next day. Some days it just doesn't work. It just doesn't. You got to know when it's not working.
This is like unlearning is harder than learning.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying? I have to like break myself of a 30-year pattern of hearing and playing this song in order to do it this new and improved way. So it's really the unlearning is harder than the learning.
Makeup.
Oh.
Makeup.
You can't help me like that. Get a brush.
No.
I look unkempt and ridiculous.
right.
Windswept and interesting.
Windswept and interesting. Never mind, Steph, you're stuck.
Give me a couple more players. You can write it out because you know what you're talking about.
I don't want to write out anything.
You don't? Why not?
I'll remember this.
Don't you love me?
I will remember.
You don't care about me anymore.
I don't know how to write this stuff. I know how to remember.
My God.
I'll let you write it. How's that? I do love you.
Do you?
Yes.
Honestly.
Treat. For the sake of making sure the time is as short as possible, we have to play this as quickly as possible without it being too quick. So, last year's version, we were too slow when we were playing. What are you doing?
I'm laughing. It's got to be quick, but not too quick.
Well, that's correct. We have to be able to phrase this song.
Do we have a precise?
Hey, we got to speed it up and slow it down.
In an English garden, waiting for the sun.
If the sun don't come, you get your tan from standing in the English rain.
So, which would you prefer to do, your lower voice or your higher voice first?
I don't know, Mike and Angela, which one should I use?
I think that you should use both of them, and I think you should use them beautifully, and I think you should paint the fucking ceiling.
Just like
In a small town, places like this close by, you know, always got to travel. And I had parents that encouraged us to get out of the house. Not like today, sitting in front of a screen and everything's make-believe, you know. We lived real lives, went out and did real things, spent a lot of times outdoors. I love the outdoors, spending times in the woods with my buddies, and a lot of times by myself too. Used to take my acoustic guitar and just head down there, and that's where I wrote my first song, actually. And the time will come when all will go away. And when the time comes, I wanna know I live my way. Thinking back on things they had to say, I remember I was told to walk my own road, walk my own road.
1964, when I was 11 years old and the Beatles landed at Kennedy Airport in New York and later played on the Ed Sullivan Show, I saw them and knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to play guitar. And I wanted to be in a band, and I wanted to be on a stage and do it for the rest of my life, playing guitar for a living. I wanted to be a Beatle. After the Beatles broke up, I was kind of lost for a while, but we weren't at a loss for talent that came along. I was also into Johnny Winter, Cream with Eric Clapton, later Led Zeppelin, with Jimmy Page, and of course Jimi Hendrix. I was into Jeff Beck. Guitar players like Santana, anybody that played a guitar. B.B. King was an early influence of mine, but the main ones, especially just as the Beatles were breaking up and during high school and after high school, were Johnny Winter and Eric Clapton and Jimmy Page. Really, those were the guys. Shibuya was actually the first place I lived away from home. I moved away from my house into the Shibuya, and while I was living there, got to see and hear some of the greatest bands in the world, and actually got to meet a lot of them too. It was quite educational and quite an entertainment thing, and it was great to be there and see the bands come in right from the beginning, watch them set up their gear and do the sound checks, and then watch the show and get to meet them afterwards if possible. It was just what an education. When I was first approached to join Avalanche, I wasn't in a very good place mentally. I didn't really want to go with another band. I had just gotten out of another band and been on the road for a while, so I really wanted to get some rest. And I was really reluctant to join the band, but when I found out who was going to be in the band and later went up and heard the direction that they were going to go in musically, I had no choice, really. I needed to do it. For me, that was one of the best decisions I ever made. Got me into a class band, a band that did all original music that I had a hand in writing, which is what I always wanted. Playing with Avalanche on the stages that we played for, the audiences that we played for, was a real step up from any of the other bands I had been in. They were the largest audiences I had ever played for, and it was night after night after night. All the audiences were almost sell out or sell out, and it was a totally different thing to be able to go on and play one good long set of all original material and have it go over the way it went over with those audiences. I believe music is the great communicator, and for me, my guitar speaks better for me than my words do. I can say more in a musical phrase sometimes than I can get across with my words.
Can't take the clouds from across the sun. I can't make this world be a free one.
Can't believe I remembered that.
It is the music. It's that vision that, you know, that you want to keep going. You just want to keep playing. It doesn't matter. The money never mattered. So what do you play for? You play for music. You play for that next discovery, that next song. It just never feels finished.
My first guitar when I was 11 years old. My mom bought me it for Christmas. I'd already been playing for about 6 months on a friend's mother's guitars, who taught me my first couple of chords. But my first guitar was $20 Woolworth's acoustic guitar from the local Five and Dime store. Yeah, the guitar I have today, I built myself for myself. It's built to my specs. Hollow-bodied Tele-style guitar with some special pickups in it. I'm very happy with it.
what keeps musicians going is the love of music, and that's what keeps this musician going, and I know that's what keeps Mike, Mark, and Barry going for sure. What I want to do for the rest of my life is play music. I mean, I'm locked into it. 'Cause
I can't catch my breath. The very fact of my presence here just chokes me half to death.
When I left James Cotton, you might think, geez, you're leaving one of the coolest blues bands on the planet. James was hot, hot, hot at that point. He had Matt Guitar Murphy and Charles Calamese, Kenny Johnson, Colin Tilton, Dave Maxwell on keys. It was a monster band. James will tell you that to this day. But when I left to go work with Michael and Avalanche, I was so excited. I didn't even miss a beat. On Avalanche show was like an avalanche. It was like rolling down the mountain and you couldn't get away from it. I don't care what you did, you could not get away from it. You could plug your ears, you could put on a shield. There was no way you could get away from an Avalanche show. Every rehearsal, it was nothing but rock and roll. And I look forward to the rehearsals as much as I did a show. I could never understand why Avalanche was not discovered playing and then playing the big arenas. And so working with Avalanche was just so exciting. It was as if I was working with Eddie Van Halen or Pete Townsend. It was just as exciting as far as I'm concerned. I'd love to show you a picture that means an awful lot to me. And you may even see why when you see this picture. There's Barry Easton, drummer for Avalanche. Charles Calamese, bass player extraordinaire. And who's this dapper young boy? I must have sold my shirt. Anyway, that's me a few years back. I want to say that was 1979 at Rehearsal Hall. And as I said before, rehearsals were like a show for us. It was no different. And anyway, I miss those days. So after leaving Avalanche, I was lucky enough to work with some of the greatest bands on the planet. The Rolling Stones, Tina Turner, ZZ Top, Carlos Santana, Pete Townsend, Frank Sinatra, 38 Special. The list goes on and on. But I miss one band, Avalanche.
Was a mission. Michael had a vision of having a strong, intense music that had a message as well. There were other heavy rock bands around, but most of them, when I listened to them, they sounded the same, almost generic. There was a formula that was followed. Michael's vision and the rest of the band's mission was to be different and to be outstanding. And that commitment to the music and their message was evident in their music. In the light of talking about Avalanche and the commitment and the dedication that they have They've continued to have. I think that if we all were able to pick our mission and stay with it with that same kind of energy and commitment, we'd all be much luckier. WCC had put out a homespun album with various artists in Connecticut, and they chose one of Avalanche's songs, Little Miss Sad Eyes, to be on the album. It was exciting to hear that very first time on the radio. Here's the biggest rock radio station in Connecticut playing Avalanche's song. Very exciting. The first show that Avalanche played at the Shabu Inn was exciting. These were friends that were going to play on the stage. I had witnessed their rehearsals and everybody was excitement. There was an electric charge in the room before they started playing. And when that first chord sounded, it was like being hit with a wall of sound. It was a complete physical reaction. You couldn't be in a room with Avalanche playing without reacting that way. Full. It was like being hit with a wall of sound in Avalanche. With all the combinations of the band, I think that they almost got there each time, and it has to have been so frustrating for Michael and all the musicians to have it end, to get so close and then miss it. And the fact that they've been still going with the same energy and the same commitment to their mission and their vision is just wonderful. My respects to them. I don't think that there's one word that can explain the love of being a musician and being on the stage and performing music. I miss being in a band still. I feel fortunate when I am in a place where somebody invites me to sit in with the band. I miss it like I've lost a limb. I still miss it so much. I think that all musicians feel the same way. When Avalanche broke up, it was devastating. It was devastating to all of the musicians. They had put in time and blood, sweat, and tears. They were just so disappointed. And everybody that knew them, that saw them be so successful with the music that they had worked so hard on, everybody was disappointed. It was a sad time.
Being in Avalanche was like one long party. And that was the show before the show, being a roadie. It was the Bruce, Brian, Mark, and DC show. And we always had a lot of good times. You know, I never looked at it like work for me. You know, moving equipment, setting up equipment, doing a show. It was probably, you know, something I really enjoyed at the time. It was a happy time. It was great times. We had a lot of fun. You know, that was probably like our Four Stooges time, and it will never be forgotten. Having the best gear. Well, we were the shit. You know, we were the bomb on the block. We had the best of the best. We had what everybody had that was out on the road. Any professional crew that was out doing, you know, shows, sound systems, everything. We had it all. We had the Crowns, we had the Yamahas, we had the 24 channel board at the time, you know, we had the microphones, we had the Marshalls, we had everything. What was Avalanche's music like? Well, it was like high energy, hard rock and roll. It was the rock and roll of the late 70s that was, you know, traditional, I guess, for the times, but we were new, we were all original, we didn't sound like anybody else, we didn't have anybody else, you know, we did one cover tune, I believe, and, you know, out of all of our songs, so, you know, we were original, and there was not a lot of original bands at the time in this area. What do I think it is that keeps musicians going, even if they haven't made it?
Well, I guess it's all about the music, and it's always been about the music. Music is deep in the soul. It's not something that's like a job that you go to every day and punch a time clock with. You know, music is a part of every musician's life. I've seen that with all the members in this band. It's not something that you let go of, because I think it's something that you were born with. And, you know, it doesn't end. It's tough, man. All right, how can I sum up in a very short amount of words what it was like for this experience? All I can say is that it was a part of my life that I'll always remember, that I'll never forget, and it'll be with me to the day I die.
Everybody's waking up. No one wants to struggle to get by. Everybody's shaking hands. Peace can only come from you and I.
Well, I've been in a lot of bands over the years, but Avalanche is the best band I've ever been in. It's what I was born to do. That's why I built this place, and just to have a place to play anytime I want is just awesome. We should be good to each other. Well, particularly for me, it's just the love of playing music and pounding on something, whether it be a rock or my drums. And you know what I'm talking about.
All right, good. We'll get the overhead set up in a minute.
Yeah, I can be serious. Never shit downwind when you're hunting.
You're not going to use that one, Barry.
You asked, man. War sucks. And, you know, I moved furniture for 30 years and moved a lot of military guys, and I hate to see them go over there. You know, they have all their families and everything that they leave behind, and that's got to be really tough. War's terrible. Shouldn't be. One more thing.
Yes.
Listen to me now, believe me later, but write it down sometime.
Thank you.
Yes.
Absolutely, I want my voice to be heard. I just don't want to be a low tone that gives the song tonal width. I want to be a little more than that. I like to see the bass as very close to the drummer, but very close to the guitars as well. Kind of this conduit that ties the whole thing together. It's great hooking up with these guys. Like you had said, we were close as youngsters, and then we all kind of went our different ways for a few years. As you know, Avalanche started with a different bass player, and I wasn't really a part of that in the beginning. Just a peripheral part of that, if you would, seeing them rehearse and watching the band grow. But God rest his soul, Charles has passed on, and they needed, they wanted to start up the thing again and start writing music. So they decided to ask me to get involved, and it's been great. Michael is the focus. Michael and Mark really are the songwriters. It's Michael's vision, what I'm trying to say. And I take a lot of direction from Michael. But then when I see the direction he's giving me start to unfold and the song takes shape, I find places where I might add a little bit here and there. And that's Michael's vision, Michael and Mark's vision. That's what keeps it cohesive and keeps it from being something that just jumps around different genres. It's got this definite vision. It's the only word I can come up for it. It's reminiscent of a Fender Jazz Bass, mm-hmm. which is a common thing that a lot of bass manufacturers are doing these days. They copy the old Fender Jazz Bass.
One of the classic bass instruments.
Absolutely, yeah. I grew up with these basses, and that's why I chose this one, because of my familiarity with the way it feels. This is made by a company called Modulus, a California company. And Modulus is mainly known for making basses with wooden bodies and necks that are made out of a graphite epoxy composite material. Space age, unaffected by weather. And what they did with this bass was they took the best of both worlds. They built a wooden neck with a wooden body, but they added graphite. There's a graphite spine that goes through the neck and a graphite plate in between the fingerboard and the neck that gives it a little more sustain, a little bit more rigidity, but it still retains that organic wooden quality of a wooden instrument.
Recording that, were you?
Jamming out a new song?
Yes, so we're going to take this once with no recorders running.
And we're going to record it?
No, we're not going to record. We're going to record it the next time, hopefully, if the rain kind of solidifies. But, Mark is timing it with stopwatch. We gotta see how much time is elapsing here. There will be fewer solos than what you're used to hearing, because we're gonna be holding them back somewhat. It's not gonna be all solos. There will be spaces left for what will be vocals, because that's why we're gonna be recording this, just to see whether or not we can make vocals work on this particular song or not. So
yeah.
It's going to be a little bit different, but hopefully everybody will know where the hell they are. Excuse me, I keep forgetting. I can't talk like that. I messed up again. Everybody ready? We'll be right back.
sorry, Sean. I was octaves. Octaves.
That's 540.
That's what I'm talking about. We gotta end the song, man. It's way too long.
That was the outro right there, right?
Yeah. Well, you know what I wanted to do was
Mark goes up the octave, and
you know what I'm doing? What I'm doing.
Part,
huh?
That's going to be a part because you did it earlier.
Well, I like it, yeah. But you know,
you should make it a part.
I want to do the second time I do that. Instead of going down, I want to go. And then that will be the signal that I'll end something up there, and we're going to go. And then Mark, at that point, will start doing his octaves to that.
Yeah.
At which point, you will probably be going up, right?
Well, Mark did it first, and then I did it.
And then I do it on top of you.
And then you went up, and then I went up again. I ended up.
Well, by then we'll be out. By then we'll be out.
And that was the end.
Yeah, we'll be out by then.
We should do a little bit of that, though, at the ending, maybe.
A little bit
and
of what?
That high part, and then we'll do it at the end.
Where Barry does the
everybody does it, and then
the snare drum fade.
Well, so
cool.
You know, you can start doing that snare drum a little bit earlier. We're going to be fading this.
Yeah, that's what.
So
I
by
think.
The time it gets into those higher registers, it's already coming down far overall. So get whatever in that you want to get in there, brother.
Get it in.
Get it out. We're going to try it again. Yeah.
Come in earlier with that, then.
All right.
I'll come in with you right after that. All right.
You know what we do that E part?
Yeah.
Where we got
Yeah.
Right, and it holds.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
When I do that, I go. That's what David was talking about. If you wanted to do something
right there
to go along
no,
with
no, to match up with him. I mean, I don't really know how you would
you
do that.
You know what, though? Playing straight through it sounds pretty good.
I like it the way it is, but I wanted to make you aware of what I was doing in case you wanted to.
No, I heard that. But
oh, you did? Okay.
Yeah, I did hear it, but I was like, nah, I'll leave you alone.
You know, at the time, Buddy Guy and Junior Wells had just recorded an album called Buddy Guy and Junior Wells Sings the Blues. And it had been produced by Eric Clapton. And here's Mike sitting in this little parking lot in Connecticut going, and Eric Clapton is the guy who plays guitar in this band Cream I've been madly involved in my head with for ever since I've ever heard him. And if I could get a band job with Buddy Guy, I could get to meet Eric Clapton. That's just the way my brain was going. And so, you know, the day that Buddy Guy showed up at the club to play their first gig, they pulled up in a van with Illinois plates, and I knew it was them because they were all black guys, Illinois plates, pulling up at about 2 in the afternoon to this nightclub, and I didn't know what they looked like, but I just took the wild guess this was them, you know, and I got out of the driver's seat, and I assumed he must be the leader of the band, so I walked up to him, and I said, excuse me, Mr. Guy, and he goes, yes, and I go, Mr. Guy, by chance, might you be looking for an organ player? being the arrogant, here I am, I'm this local kid you've been waiting for all your life kind of thing. And he looks me square in the eyes and he goes, why, boy, do you think you can cut it? And again, being the fool and the arrogant person that I was, I said, well, yeah, I think I can cut it. He goes, well, we hit it at 9. You might want to be here at 8. And he walked into the club, and that was it. He didn't think twice about it. And meanwhile, I'm ready for a nervous breakdown. I immediately jump in my car, and I drive up to the University of Connecticut, which is about 6 miles away, to their underground record store, and bought every Buddy Guy record they had in the store, thinking I'd learn all these songs in 3 hours or 4 hours in time for the show. And, you know, I started listening to these records. And, you know, the first one was something like, you know, I'm going to go up in the country and paint my mailbox blue. And then the second one would be, I got the blues because my little red rooster done left me. And I'd go, I can't tell one from the other. They all sound the same. They all have these similar titles. They sound like they're the same song over and over again. What am I going to do here? And, you know, I'd been playing Traffic and Three Dog Night and Steppenwolf and, you know, whatever was striking my fancy back then out of the bands that I liked, but blues had not been it. So I set my Hammond organ up in the afternoon, and at 8 o'clock I showed up, and, you know, I think at about 5 or 9, they started walking down from the upstairs, and they said, well, you're going to play, aren't you? And I said, okay, and I followed them onto the stage, and I thought they were going to go, well, this is, I'm going down to the country to paint my mailbox blue, and it's in the key of A. And they didn't do anything like that. Buddy Guy just looked in my direction. He didn't even look at me. He just sort of glanced in my direction and goes, this one's in G. And they started playing. And it was like, oh, what song is this? You know? And all I could do was play what I thought might sound okay with whatever it is I heard them doing, and guess about what was coming next. And fortunately, I had pretty good instincts about what was coming next, I guess, because there weren't a whole lot of massive train wrecks in the music. And the wonderful thing about a Hammond organ is you can cut back on the volume instantly with a gas pedal. So when I was in doubt, it wasn't as noticeable for some of these people in the audience. And I can remember I played about 4 songs like that, and I couldn't stop staring at the floor. I didn't dare look at the crowd. I didn't want to look at the band. It was kind of like, I know that I am making a fool of myself right now. And he walked up to the microphone after the 4th song Buddy Guy did, and he looks at the crowd, and he goes, I want to thank you all for coming out here. This is quite a crowd. And
thank you very much. What can I say? What can I say, ladies and gentlemen?
And everybody cheers and everything, and he goes, so, let me ask you guys something. He goes, what are y'all here thinking of this young man? You know, we got here playing on the organ. And they all went crazy out in the audience. I mean, some of them were local people, and I'm sure that had something to do with it, but a lot of them weren't. And he looked at me, and for the first time, he smiled. And he goes, then he looks back at the audience, and he gets to the microphone, and he goes, I do believe we're going to take this young man back to Chicago with us. And that's how I got the gig with Buddy Guy. I almost crapped my pants. I could not believe what I was hearing.